The Iron Game Chalk Talk Podcast is brought to you by the following sponsors: EliteForm.com, IgnitionAPG.com, PlayUSA at PLAEUSA.com, and Sorinex Exercise Equipment at Sorinex.com. And now, the Iron Game Chalk Talk Podcast. Welcome to Iron Game Chalk Talk with your host, Ron McKeefery.
Every time our athletes walk into this weight room, they're going to be pushed to the max.
Let's go! Let's go! Everything you got!
On this podcast, hear Coach McKeefery's straight talk about training, featuring the top strength and conditioning professionals from around the world. And now, here's your host, Ron McKeefery.
Hey guys, welcome back to Iron Game Chalk Talk. I'm your host, Ron McKeefery, and this episode number 150. Super excited to have Tim Pelot with us. Tim is the strength and conditioning sports physiologist out in Anaheim with the USOC, United States Olympic Committee. They're getting our athletes ready to go for Rio this year. And as you know, and I've talked about on this show, I am a big fan of the Olympics. I love every single thing about it. I love the idea of competing on a global stage, the history. I'll sit there and I'll watch every single event that I possibly can during the Olympics and chill like crazy for just feats of athleticism. It's just unbelievable to see athletes from around the world compete at the highest levels. And obviously love the United States, love our athletes and the people that are preparing them, and really truly appreciate Tim and the rest of the staff that's working with our athletes. Obviously with the Olympics and the travel and the preparation for 4 years and the whole deal, there's tons of challenges. And so we get into that quite a bit. We specifically talk about rest and recovery strategies and some of the things that they do, and just some really, really good nuggets for anybody that's listening to take away. Before we do, though, we want to make sure we recognize our sponsor, Play. So thankful. This is the 150th episode of Iron Game Chalk Talk. We're one away from the three-year anniversary of the show. I can't believe that those words are coming out of my mouth. But so appreciative of Play for being pretty much a part of it since the beginning. They were the first sponsor. They were there. Way back in 2013 when we started it off, and truly appreciate not only them sponsoring the show and making it so it's free for you guys, but you know the role that they've played in my personal development. You know, Rich and Brett and the rest of the staff. I mean, they're people that I lean on for different things within this field. The platforms that they've created with the Play Summits and some of the educational initiatives that they've supported. To give back to our community, and then putting out a great product. You know, if you're in the market for a floor, this is the best product out there for sports flooring as stands right now, and they're constantly innovating new and better solutions to our challenges. And so if you're in the market, I would highly recommend you reach out to Play. If you're not, reach out to them and just let them know how much you appreciate them being a part of everything that we, that we do from an educational standpoint and being a part of this show. And so can't thank Play enough for what they do. Lastly, Ask Coach Mac has been going strong. It's a new podcast that I've started. I would highly recommend that if you have a strength and conditioning question to reach out through AskCoachMac.com and ask a question. You can leave a voicemail right there at the bottom of the page by clicking the start recording button and ask your question right there. And if it's a question that I feel that everybody would benefit from, we'll feature it on the show. But we're about 13 episodes in when this goes live, and answering some great questions and getting tons of great feedback from it. So I would encourage you to reach out, ask your questions there, subscribe by going to iTunes or Stitcher. You can click on the links right here, and then you'll get it drop to your inbox each week. So sit back, enjoy this episode. I know you're going to get a ton out of Tim's talk here, and look forward to seeing you on the other side. All right, guys, welcome back to Iron Game Chalk Talk. Excited to have Tim Pelot with us. Tim is with the USOC He's getting our athletes ready for the Olympics here and just doing a fantastic job. We got a chance to bump into him at the conference here recently. And man, from afar, respect what you're doing and how you're doing it and truly appreciate you coming on the show.
Great. Well, Ron, I'm really fired up. Thanks for giving me the opportunity here. To just talk and just kind of share some of the things that we're doing. I'm excited.
That's great, man. Well, hey, let's take it back a little bit. Let's talk Reader's Digest version of kind of how you got into the field and then what's led you there to the Olympic Committee.
Oh man. It's been about a 15-year journey at this point in the field. I, like you, like to use the motto, how I grew up in strength and conditioning. I think I started in 2000 doing strength and conditioning as an assistant at a school, a D2 school, volunteering, seeing what was going on. Actually, when I went to college, I wasn't even planning on doing anything exercise training related. I was gonna go be an engineer, and then I changed that because the math just kind of weeded me out real fast. And then I went to go into some business classes, and I kind of enjoyed it. But then some of the courses, I just was finding myself fall asleep and didn't have a strong passion for it. So then I kind of changed gears, got into kines and got into biomechanics, got into training, started understanding some physiology, and it just kind of hit me pretty hard like a sledgehammer. And so then that just kind of led me down the path. I wanted to learn more, got really excited, found myself, you know, in the library till midnight, you know, on my own, because there was, you know, the journal section in our library. It was like the ACSMs and all these, and I was just, right, you know, getting out of the textbook, so to speak, and getting into the journals. And, you know, I have actually, it really was just eye-opening, you know, just how in deep, you know, how in depth the field is. And it really kind of just struck me. So I made a decision that is something I wanted to do, and I wanted to pursue it. So I left my GA position after I graduated. Had applied to the USOC back in 2003. And then from there, I had gotten a couple calls from the biomechanics labs. I got a couple calls from the exercise physiology and the strength conditioning to figure out what I was really interested in. And then we kind of went into the strength route. And so I'll tell you, I'm here as, and I'm just a product of the people before me. You know, I think I'm not really somebody that will tell you that I've created myself by any means. I think I've just been really fortunate to be able to have had some internships at the USOC. I've had some internships at Carmichael Training Systems. I've had some internships, physiologists, biomechanics, States in the past 15 years, as you know what that's like. And you know, I got married and my wife went to two of them with me, and it's a tough road. And but I think if you're willing to be a good learner and, you know, and know the role that we all have, then I think that if you're persistent enough, you'll find where you want to go. It'll find you.
Absolutely. Well, it's definitely a journey, and I love asking that question because, I mean, like we were talking a little bit off camera, it's never an overnight success. It's always a bumpy road, and there's always forks in the road where they both seem like they could be great answers as well. You know, that you could go right or left, and they both seem right. And sometimes it's just you got to take a chance, and you got to make what I call strategic choices. They're going to help lead you down to ultimately when you close your eyes at night, where do you see yourself being? And so, for me, that was, you know, I could took the AAA job with the Kansas City Royals, making pretty good money out of college, working at the highest level, one step away from being a major league, you know, head strength coach, or I could go be an intern unpaid for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, you know, but football was my passion, you know, and I know you've made those choices. You know, you talked a little bit about the internship process with the USOC and the teachers that you had. You know, one of the things that I respect, and I applied for that internship back in college. I remember specifically doing it, and you know, it's a unique environment there. And I've had the pleasure to work with some people that have worked at the USOC, and know a lot of people that work at the USOC. And with Olympic sport countries, you know, they've taken the high performance model approach. They've taken the you know, that really, you know, really more of a clinical and a laboratory type approach to some degree. And then there obviously some phenomenal coaches that have come in that have really enhanced the coaching component as well. And so, you know, I want to talk to you a little bit about when you first showed up and you didn't have that skill set, you know, and you were surrounded with these people that were working at this highest level and working with athletes at the highest level. How did you go about kind of catching up?
Oh, man, I never actually thought about it in that regard for a long time, I think. But, you know, going back, I mean, here I am. I'm coming out of college. Got my a quote that I use weekly is, I feel that I was probably the smartest I've ever been 5 years outside of college. Hold on one sec here, Ron. Oh, yeah, no problem. And basically what that means is, you know, I got out of school. I had a master's degree. I'd gotten in some internships at the USOC. And I felt like at that point, like, man, I'm just getting kind of frustrated in the field because and it's a huge failure on my part, but it was a huge growth moment because I started feeling like, wow, I was around all these great people. Like, I'm so smart. Like, all these people just don't understand. They just don't get it. And, you know, to this day, I still don't feel I am as smart as I was 5 years out of my master's degree, which, you know, it just goes to show like how much, you know, the growth process happens, you know, from your, and taking that into your question is, you know, when I got there, we had a biomechanics department, we had exercise physiologists. I actually did my internship in Lake Placid. John Carlock was my mentor while I was there. And John Carlock now is doing some stuff with the special forces units, but his background really taught me a lot. We went through Olympic lifting. We went through exercise physiology, had said some stuff that's been published. We also had a biomechanics department that was basically attached to the weight room. We had force plates. We have the big, you know, Nordic treadmills. And so we would kind of utilize this cross-pollinated section where I would go over there and spend some time. And then I'd be in the weight room and we're doing monitoring or we're, you know, working with bobsled skeleton, bobsled skeleton, luge, biathlon, you know, all the winter-based sports. And I was there for 8 months. So I was completely in over my head. Right. And I think you had mentioned a quote in your book about how you never really think you're going to be ready for the next role, right? And so for me, it was one of those things where I thought I was top dog. You know, I was a big fish in a small pond at my D2 school, and nobody else's. I didn't have in my school. I had somebody above me, but then he left, and so I started doing some of the stuff, and there was nobody above me. So here I am thinking like this is the stuff, and everybody's doing it like this, and I just didn't have any exposure to brighter minds and people who have been doing it longer. And it was a real big like eye opener to me about how much I did not know. Even though I was spending hours in journals and I was, you know, trying to do with everything I could to learn from the resources that were available to me, it just I just wasn't ready. And so I got there and, you know, I just became super humbled really fast. And learning, and then at that point I was like, wow, I thought I knew a lot. Then I had to just assume this learner's role. And the challenge I think in that is that I had to step back and be okay with telling people that I didn't know.
Right.
And I think that's the hardest part is that we start learning and want people to respect you. And, you know, people are going to respect you if you know more stuff. Where I was getting to the point where if I told them that I knew something, they were going to give me that job. And then I would actually make myself look worse.
That's right.
But I think what ended up happening is that those professionals respected my ability to say that I didn't know something. And then because of that, they actually dumped more knowledge in me. Right. And they spent more time with me and they mentored me more. And that was probably one of the biggest steps that I think that I could have taken as a young coach is just admitting that I don't need to know everything.
Right.
You know, and respect doesn't come just from being the know-it-all.
Agreed. I agree. I think that's an important step in every coach's life. I mean, I always say on the show that, you know, when you get in, you know it all. You know, you talk to coaches that have been in it, you know, they'll tell you that as they age and as they progress in the field, they just start to learn to ask the right questions, let alone have all the answers, you know. And I think that's where we're all at now. It's we're starting to ask the right questions. And then I actually got an email from somebody else that said that they didn't like that statement. But what they liked, that what they thought of was how they would humble themselves or allow themselves to learn from the right people. You know, I think seeking out the right people is important as well. And in that community, in the USOC community, there's some phenomenal. John Carlock, you mentioned, I worked side by side with Special Forces for a little bit, and a freaking phenomenal mind in strength and conditioning as well. But I mean, you're surrounded by that. When specifically talking about the different sports, okay, from a sport application standpoint, I mean, some of those sports you probably never even heard of, let alone worked with.
Man,
you know, how did you go about learning the physical demands, the skill acquisition, the things that were going to go into making them the best luger in the world, let alone going out there and doing it, as a pick me up sport, at a Division II.
It's so different, and I think. You know, I think one of the things that I really think it's important to share is that the information that I will kind of share, it just comes out of the world of my environment. You know, I think it's important that doesn't necessarily mean it's the right information for somebody else's environment. I think, you know, taking bits and pieces and nuggets is so for me, when I ended up going from the NC2A to USOC, I mean, the athlete is different. It's a way different athlete. I mean, the sport in and of itself, I mean, shoot, in Florida, we don't have tracks. We don't have ice tracks, and we don't have, those type of sports. The only exposure I really had was watching him at the Olympic Games.
Right.
So literally, I mean, I was in over my head when it came to the sports because I didn't know anything about them. I was in over my head because I had these guys who were so much smarter than I was. I think just at the end of the day, assuming, and this just goes back to reiterate the point that I had earlier, is just assuming – the role of just being a great learner, you know, and I think sitting back and watching and not coming in super hot and heavy saying like, hey, I'm the expert and I can show you how to do this. And, you know, it buys you a lot of credibility. I think for science, one of the things I've learned is for science to, and this is still reigns true, in order for science to be effective, we have to have influence. And if we don't have influence, then our science doesn't help us do anything. And so for me, I could have come in super hot and heavy, and I would have had some decent science because I'm integrating the science that their head coach is telling me to help them with, but they don't give me any credibility because they don't know me. So I had to really spend a lot of time learning that relationship factor. I had to get their trust. I had to understand them. I had to learn about the elite Olympic athlete. I had to learn about what that meant for them, you know, how often they train, how long they train, how many years they've trained.
Right.
We had an intern that just started with us yesterday, and he's 24 years old. And what I asked him is I said, well, I want to share with you that we have an athlete here who's been to 3 Olympic Games. And so 3 Olympic Games, that's
half your life.
You know, well, that's 12 years. So where were you 12 years ago?
Right.
And he's 24, you know, he's 8 years old.
Right.
And I was telling him, like, this guy has been training for, that's the Olympic Games, but he's been training before his first Olympic Games.
Right.
So he's got 16 years of elite training. He's been around elite training, who, you know, and he's probably had 8 of them, you know, over the course of 16 years or 6 of them. And here you are, you're now an intern with me, day one, you're 24, what are you going to teach this guy?
Right, right.
So, you know, so the role that our interns play is just different. You know, we have athletes that are very smart, that have been doing this for a long time, but then we also have the athletes that come in, they're either developmental or they're their first year or second year in. So just, I think learning the Olympic community and what the, I say Olympic a lot, I'm probably going to go national team. It's a better way to say it. The national team setting is, it has an environment, it has a culture. And it's just, it's unique.
Yeah.
So learning that I think was really important.
So you talked about, you know, the challenges of getting to know the Olympic athletes and to not lead with just how much you know, but an experience when you're faced with sometimes athletes that have been doing it longer than you've been coaching, let alone, and you talk about, having to go through the maturation process of not know, you know, to humble yourself, to allow yourself to learn. What's maybe the biggest mistake you've made with the athlete specifically as a strength coach, and then how did you learn from that?
Man, so I'm my philosophy, I'll just try to be quick on it. I'm a big believer in failure.
Yeah.
You know, I think they create opportunities for us to get better if we look for them. You know, if we don't look for them, or if we're not always kind of trying to refine our process, then I think then failure could be super bad. But I think if we're good learners, then I think it could be fantastic. So, man, that's a great. Man, I've messed up a lot, man. I'm not perfect. I mean, even to this day, you know, I look back at, you know, the biggest thing. You know, this is a really hot topic, actually. So one of the things that I think is really important, and it's a big mistake. And I don't know if it's the biggest, I'd have to spend some time on that. But one of the things that one of my coaching core values is to teach. I'm a teacher, and I teach because I believe that I can increase a workout's effectiveness and impact if an athlete truly understands what we're trying to do.
Right.
You know, at the end of the day, they're the one that has to make the decision on the effort, not me. You know, I can't make that decision for them. And if I could make that decision for them, then I wouldn't need to educate them anymore. But I need – so, you know, so I think one of the things that I've learned is that because I'm a teacher, I've also had to learn how much I give. How much do I tell them?
Right.
And I found out there are specific things when it comes to the science that I'm quite passionate about. You know, the sports science, the exercise science, science, you know, I don't know what that means nowadays, whether it's technology or physiology or biomechanics, whatever, just this
right.
pretty in depth. But I think there's a point where we need to protect our athletes from some of the science. And I say that with a couple pieces of information. I think the biggest thing that I think I learned is that for everything that we do, a physical stress, there's a psychological toll. And I think that the biggest strategy that I've had to change is years ago when I was a younger coach, I used to try to sell my athletes and say, hey, you need to do this because it's going to make you better, or you're going to lose this,
right?
You know, and, or you need to do this, or you're not going to be able to do this. You know, it almost had like a negative connotation to it. Like,
great.
I was selling it in a way where it was, like a scare tactic. You know, like, you're going to lose this much performance if you don't do this, you know, or, hey, you need, and then next thing you know, they're like, oh, yeah, well, I'll prove you wrong. So right. That competitive nature. So I think right. What I've ended up learning is, you know, that comes more along the lines of behaviors. If you want to get into rest and recovery, we can talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah.
But I think I've learned a ton about how the information that I'm giving is super important. And I've also learned that too much science can get in our way when it comes to the information that we're giving. So I've kind of created these filters or lenses that I have to say, okay, this is probably a pretty good thing for me to share. This maybe not so good because this creates a psychological toll. There's right. a psychological tax that we're going to have to pay if I share this information. And so I think that's probably a big learning point.
Yeah, absolutely. And we all have to go through that process as well. You mentioned, you know, the rest recovery, and I think that's, you know, anytime I talk to a coach like yourself that does as much traveling as you do and competing, you know, sometimes multiple times a day and the whole deal, the rest recovery tactics and strategies really is something that I always think about. Give us some nuggets, give us some takeaways, some things that you've learned through your process of dealing with the stresses of sometimes unbearable stress and competition and travel and things that we can take and apply to maybe to those NCAA athletes.
Okay. So this is an area that we're still trying to learn. You sure. know, I think And so I think just kind of prefacing this whole topic is, I think everybody has a different world, and, you know, they might learn things a little differently or strategies that may or may not work. So I'm going to kind of speak a little bit specifically to my world and what I've done and kind of how I've, what I've learned and tuned. You know, I think, you know, so just to provide a little bit of a background here. So our athletes, you know, we travel. It's our sport. We travel. We're based, the sports that I work with, we're based in Southern California. You know, we compete internationally. And so we travel to Brazil, we travel to Europe, we travel to Russia, we travel to, you know, China and Japan, 3, 4, 5, up to 12 times a year. You know, and so every year with these sports, we have different tournaments where, for example, men's volleyball, which is a team that I work with, they have a world league, and every weekend they're in a different country. Mm-hmm. So they'll go to Turkey, and then they'll go to Poland, and then they'll go to Brazil, and then they go to Russia, and then they come back in the U.S. and finish out that tournament. So they're on the road for 4 to 5, maybe up to 6 weeks at a time. Wow. So when we think about rest, we think about recovery, we think about regeneration, you know, I think the hurdles that I have to overcome, we have to kind of identify that. And I think those hurdles would be, well, let me back up and say, you know, the science that we try to study will tell us, like, we need to sleep well. You know, sleep is a really important thing. You know, we got to stretch, we've got to stay active. You know, we got to eat right, we got to stay hydrated. You know, and one of the things that I think, and I don't want to get too long-winded here, but we have to, you know, our goal in our travel around rest, recovery, and regen is to preserve our performance. Mm-hmm. You know, we train super hard when we're home. We're training in sport super hard. We are in our strength and conditioning sessions, and we're lifting, and we're doing conditioning, you know, at a really high level. And then when we leave and we hit the road, we're on the plane. Sometimes travel goes up to, we've had 36-hour travel sessions where we're in transit for 36 hours. We're hopping on 4 or 5 different, you know, segments of flights. We have a layover in an airport for 6 hours. Right. And at the end of the day, we have to leave that travel and play at a super high level, you know, best in the world level, if we're going to be successful.
Right.
So there's a lot of things that are in our way. And so we try to remove some of those barriers. You know, one of them is we have to try to make things consistent. So we got to make sure our food is consistent. If we're traveling and we're not eating, that's not good. And so we got to make sure that we're eating on the road the same way that we're eating at home. Because it's easy, because being in an airport, being on a plane, it's just different. So maybe we're not used to drinking as much. You know, in training, it's easy to drink because we're sweating. We're working hard. We're drinking water.
Right.
We've also found that, you know, sleep. I mean, there's been so much homework on sleep, and it seems like it's the buzzword as of the, you know. But it is really important. But one of the things that we have found is that if we spend too much time talking about sleep, or we spend too much time stressing about sleep, we're actually creating a stress in our athletes about sleep.
Right.
If they're not so, and this is kind of rest, recovery, regeneration tactics. I mean, the sleep is a really big one. There's a lot of scientists, and there's a lot of people that I've heard get out and present and talk about how everybody needs to get more sleep, and there's a lot of studies done on need more, need more, need more, and I guess I can't disagree with that. But what I've also found is with my athletes, I have to be really careful about how I present that information to them. And we have a lot of scientists in the world of performance that do some really good homework about its impact. But if I share its impact with the athletes, all I'm now doing is creating more stress within them.
That's a great point.
So we've had some scientists, some sleep scientists from NASA come and talk to our teams. We've had some of the doctors from Stanford and some other real big universities come and do some presentations and talk about sleep and its role. And it's created a lot of problems because of that. And why I say that is because there's a psychological toll and there's a psychological tax. And so what happens when we do a presentation for athletes and we tell them that if they don't get this many hours of sleep a night before their game, they're going to lose 25% of their performance, and they have to be at their best that next day. That has a big problem. That's a big problem with that.
Absolutely. especially athletes are head cases as it is a lot of times.
Well, yeah, 100%. And so that's, I mean, so rest, so I'm only really going to talk about that one. I mean, we could talk about flights, and there's a huge dynamic around flights and what that does, but sleep is kind of the hot topic right now. You know, we've had a, I'll give you a couple stories that we've had to, had to overcome. Other thing that we have to, so with our world, we're jumping 6 time zones, 8 right. time zones, 9 time zones, 10 right. time zones within a 24-hour period. And then we're expected, you know, we are expecting to be at our best 2 days out from our travel, and our circadian rhythm is way in flux. So when our body thinks it's day, it's actually at 1 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
So although this might not be as much of a challenge in the NC2A and the high school world, but for our level, it's a real big challenge. And so we've found that, you know, sleep science is really important, but we can't, I've had to personally have talks with my athletes after these really elaborate presentations.
Right.
Or that scientist isn't the one getting the phone call at 8 o'clock in the morning from my athlete who's in Berlin competing in a Grand Slam, and it's 4 a.m. there and they can't sleep and they have a gold medal match that day.
That's right. Yeah.
So I'm, you know, applied science, applied sports science. I think we have sports science, but I think how we apply it in recognizing, you know, athletes will stress out. You tell them that it's going to impact their performance. There's going to be some stress related. And there's things that we can work on behaviorally to improve our ability to sleep.
Right.
But if you have planted a seed that sleep is so important that they won't perform and they wake up in the middle of the night because their circadian rhythm is all off, and now they're stressed that they're not sleeping, now they're not going to sleep because they're stressed about not sleeping.
Right. Well, so when you hear that, when you hear those doctors speak, I mean, because it's just like it's a chicken and egg. I mean, we want the information as coaches. We want the information.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, and it's, you know, it's, I always talk to my coaches about, you know, not dumbing it down. It's not the right word, but making it. I always tell them that they need to be able to explain it to, you know, my 13-year-old daughter. You know, you need to take the complex and make it, you know, and make it simplified enough to where you could explain it to my daughter is what I always tell them. And so you get that information, they scare the crap out of your athletes. It creates some additional stress, whatever. How have you gone about combating that? And then what have been some of those strategies that you've said, okay, all right, they're having trouble, they're jumping 10 time zones, or, you know, how are you telling them to, you know, to approach their sleep, approach their hydration, approach their flexibility?
You know what, we try to de-emphasize the intensity around it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think as much as we want to intensify it as scientists, and we respect the hard science, we have to almost desensitize it and say, you know what, it doesn't matter. You just got to go. You know, and I hate that sounds so old school, but it's so true. I mean, that's basically the conversation I've got 3 stories around this kind of scenario. So one is an athlete in Berlin who called me and was like, hey, I'm really stressing out here. I haven't been sleeping. I've got my – so she had a semifinal in the morning, and then she had the grand final in the afternoon. And I'm like, here's the deal. You can't control anything at this point in time. You just have to go, and you have to trust your, training. You know, you've worked super hard. You've done what you've done. And what I always say is that adrenaline is a really magical drug that we can't study. Great. You know, adrenaline helps us kind of push through some gaps that we potentially can't necessarily always measure when it comes to a very controlled environment. So I say adrenaline will be on your side. You gotta realize that we'll always be there. Now I'm not taking away the importance of sleep, because I think it is miraculous in what it can do.
Right.
I just believe that we have to, as coaches in this community, we have to really be better about how we communicate some messages. Another example, and this will be my last one, is we had a, you know, I have a lot of older athletes. I've got athletes that are 40 years old. I've got athletes in their 30s. I've got athletes in their 20s. And some of our doctors, we have doctors that travel with us, and they care Ambien. you know, because we believe that it helps us potentially cross some time zones. It helps us maybe get into some different sleeping patterns, or it'll help us get to sleep faster. Well, what if you have an athlete who's a veteran and has been around for a while, and there's up and comers that are coming on board, and they're real fast, they're real sharp, they play the game really, really well. Veteran's feeling a little bit threatened potentially about losing his job. Sleep doctor comes in and says sleep is super important. And now what ends up happening is that, again, this is the really far end of the bell curve, is the athlete has been using Ambien for years during travel. You know, we use it for short stints. We don't use it all the time. It's for that initial. Well, he started taking one and then maybe two Ambien. Well, we're off site. We're traveling. We're on the road. I get a knock on my door at 3 o'clock in the morning. And I was like, I'm sleeping. Leave me alone. I get it, you know, keeps knocking. So I get to the door. This athlete is at my door. And he's looking at me, and he looks high as a kite. Like, and we have, again, this is the severity of it, is it's a gold medal match the next day.
Right.
It's a tournament. And so he's really wanting to make sure that he gets his sleep. Well, he popped an Ambien, and he's now walking around like a zombie. Because he's so worried about getting his sleep, taking some, you know, and so he's, and now we have a whole, he's knocked on every single athlete's door in the hotel that we were staying in. So now the whole team has interrupted their sleep.
Yeah.
He's asking people, hey, at the end of the day, he didn't play the next day. but because it was all this fear that was struck deep inside of him. And so that's just wanted to kind of bring that up, because I think that's important.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great and valid point. And, you know, so much of coaching is the message and delivering the message. And, you know, I always talk to our coaches and our athletes about, you know, being away at college, especially when they're freshman year. It's one of the most stressful times in their entire life. I mean, you look at all the statistics and the studies that show, you know, getting married or losing a parent or going away to college, or those are the most stressful times in your life. And you throw that on top of the stresses that come with athletics, and it's a recipe for disaster unless you address it, you know, and you minimize it, because you're right. Sometimes you have to throw the physiology textbook out the window. I mean, you can survive on 3 hours of sleep. You can show countless examples of athletes that have been running 102 temperature and gone out there and performed at an unbelievable level. You know, sometimes it's just, you know, you got to suck it up and you got to go. And it's great and refreshing to hear that that's happening there as well, you know?
Well, and to bring back to that conversation, the athlete that was in Berlin, she won Grand Slam. She gold medaled that tournament.
That's awesome.
And so I think, to me, it's always how do we tie what we do back to medal winning performances? And to me, with the training that we implement, we're always trying to find ways to correlate, like, is this truly making us better in sport? Like, I can measure your vertical. I can see you squat. I can see you do all these movements, and I can look at your training manual or your blog or your binder, and I can see progressions and I can see things changing.
Right.
But that doesn't necessarily mean that the athlete's actually feeling better. They're moving better. They're recovering faster. And so for me, when I'm always asking questions after tournaments, hey, how did that feel? Where are we at? Is this working? How are we trending? And so going back to, we can push through. We got to be careful. We can still win.
Right.
You know, adrenaline is a really amazing thing. That's just on sleep. That's one nugget on recovery. There's so many other factors.
No question. Well, you know, I want to switch gears a little bit. I want to talk, you know, one of the things that I really I've always respected and like about the USOC and Olympic sport countries in general is the emphasis placed on winning. You know, I mean, obviously, you know, we all love the fact that what sport does for your life and all the values and characteristics and things that it builds. But at the end of the day, you know, especially when you get to the college and the pro and the Olympic level, it's about wins and losses, you know, and so how do you guys address, I mean, you talk about that veteran athlete that's maybe a little bit, you know, leery of somebody taking their spot on the roster or how, you know, the athlete that, you know, that just shows up, that's young and dumb and ready to go and can take on the world. How do they put in their place, you know, versus that athlete that's won a couple of medals? I mean, I remember walking into, out of Colorado Springs and Amanda Whitmire talking about, look, it's the resources are placed on the medal winners, once you've earned that medal, then now it's a different level of attention and things along those lines, I guess. Mm-hmm. But how do you guys address this, that internal hierarchy of dealing with athletes and then how do you stress that importance on winning?
Oh man, that's a monster topic. I think, the USOC allocates, just like Amanda had mentioned, allocates resources based upon medal contention or the potential to medal to do well in an Olympic Games or an international competition. The role that I have out here, it's unique because the teams that I work with have had a lot of success in international competition. And I will be the first one to say that it really bleeds down from coaching, mm-hmm. From the head coach. I think the biggest challenge when it comes to success is that it could either encourage the behavior that we had because of a success that we had. And I think one of the things that we try to do best is we try to be successful in our process versus be successful on the podium. And I think that if what that comes back down to is what are the things that we can be successful in and how can we control that? Because we can control our process. We can control everything that we do every single day. We can't honestly control the outcome of a match. We can increase the likelihood of it to go in our favor, but that's not to say that we're in 100% control of that. So I think the coaches that I work with, the head coaches that I work with, do a phenomenal job of making sure that excellence is brought to the table every day. And I think they also do a really great job of the veteran athletes who have had some very amazing success, world champions, Olympic champions. They do a really good job of not letting that individual athlete become – I mean, everybody respects them for their work that they've done. But at the end of the day, that athlete also has to assume the role of being a part of the team.
Right. Right.
And so if that one person becomes too big, then the infrastructure of the team can fall apart. And I think that that's the other side of like coaching and team dynamics, and pulse on the team and the group camaraderie. I mean, the cliques that can happen within teams.
Right.
I attribute the success of our teams because the way that our coaches can create seamless and a seamless environment within the individuals. There's the precedence is on process, and everybody holding each other accountable. It's not, hey, this is what this champion said about this is what we should be doing, or individuals becoming bigger than the goal.
Right.
We have kind of the selfless value, core value that it resonates really well with the athletes and the teams that I work with.
Yeah, I think that's awesome. I think that's maybe a better way of putting that early on would have been, just the role that this entitlement has played in sport, and it's all, the thing about it, having been at the professional level and the college level and know guys like yourself at the USOC's level or Olympic level, it's almost the higher you go, the more humbled and less entitled you are. I mean, you talk about Olympic, you're going for, and there's some athletes making money, but for the most part, most of them aren't, right? But they're the best in the world. They train for 4 years for a hundredth of a second improvement on their PR. And yet they're some of the most humble people in the world. And you take that down to maybe the high school level sometimes, and some of these athletes are walking around the most entitled human being on the planet. And it's like, how are we so far away in from that understanding, And what I love about the Olympic athlete, the Olympic committee is the fact that they're, it's like the proof's in the pudding. You know, it's like you either your work does the talking for you, you don't do the talking. Right. And so you guys do such a fantastic job of that, man. But hey, we end the show. This has been a freaking phenomenal conversation, but we end the show with some resources. Give us the best piece of coaching advice you ever received.
You know, I think you hit the nail on the head earlier in this conversation. And the best coaching advice in the field that I think that I could give to somebody is not so much about chasing job titles. You know, in this world of our profession, I think director roles and head coach roles, they might sound nice, but that doesn't mean it is nice.
Right.
So I think, you know, if for me, what I have found is that the best advice that I give is find great people and find ways to be around those people. Find ways where their charisma, find ways where their knowledge, find ways where just pieces of them can somehow just saturate you, you know, fall into your head, you know, into the way that you act. And I think that if you do that without searching, hey, I've got to be at this big school or I've got to be at this elite organization, because there's a lot of really smart, fantastic coaches all over in every aspect, whether it's high school, whether it's college, whether it's pro. It's not just, hey, pro, D1. I mean, there's phenomenal doing great things, even in the private sector. And I think you have to find the right people, because they're going to give you the pearls of wisdom. They're going to give you the advice. And they know a lot of people.
Right.
So you're going to tap into their network. Not only are you going to tap into their knowledge, you're tapping into their network. Agreed. And if you do good work for them, that's where you go. So that would be the coaching advice for the young coaches.
Oh, that's great. What about give us a book inside strength and conditioning and outside of strength and conditioning, and then an app and a website recommendation.
You know, I'm a I dive into journals a lot. Journal of Biomechanics, Journal of Athletic Training, Journal of Strength and Conditioning. You know, all these different journals. So I dive into journals quite frequently. What I have found is that, and I think I hit a little bit earlier, is that more science doesn't make me better coach. Doesn't make me a better coach. I think it helps me plan, it helps me program, it helps my thought process, but it doesn't help me deliver and present and communicate and receive the intention of the training that I'm actually wanting.
Right.
So I think, so for me, like coaching books, I'm a big fan of John Maxwell. I think you are as well.
Yep.
He wrote a book, says everybody communicates, but few connect. And I think that speaks loudly to me, because in this world, it seems there's a lot of buzzwords that pop up, or a new slang term that is really hot and buzzy. And it's pretty much almost the same thing that was around 5 years ago, but somebody just called it something different. Or if we speak in a really high intellectual way, then we are really smart, and our athletes or our coaches will believe that we're really, you know, we know what we're doing.
Sure.
And I think the better we can be at communicating our message, getting trust, developing relationships, makes your science really do some great things. So that would be a coaching. And then apps, you know, we use the I still call it UberSense, but it's the technique, and I think it's got another one that we use quite a bit on the floor. You know, and another app that I use, and this is going to sound a little crazy, but I try to learn about, and we have prescribed workouts that we do for running or metabolic purposes outside of the training room or the training environment. So there's an app called Runkeeper that I really like, because it sends me a notification every time somebody goes out and gets, you know, something that we have on our sheet done.
Oh yeah. That's pretty cool.
And it's, I think, I mean, apps can get a little crazy. I have, you know, use the Dartfish apps and all that kind of stuff.
What about websites that you generally check out?
Ooh, You know, I bounce back and forth with between a bunch of different websites. I mean, it's so crazy, the social media. And actually, it's quite frightening to me how much is out there. I think if I was, you know, 15 years ago and I had as much information available to me then as that I have now, it would be it's really scary. Don't because yeah, I mean I mean it's like going to Home Depot and having all of those supplies but not knowing what to do with any of them.
That's right.
You know, like you don't, and you got to know how to use the hammer, and you've got to know how to connect a board, or you got to know how to connect a faucet, you know. And I think a lot of times, so websites, I don't know, I have, you know, Mike Young, I'm a big fan of Mike Young. Mike Young is, he was with the Vancouver Whitecaps for a while. He's got a facility down in the Carolinas. He's got a Elite Track is his website. I really have valued a lot of the things that he's had on his website over the years. So I think I'd give that a recommendation because he has a lot of great links and articles and stuff that he puts out.
Wow, that's great, man. Well, buddy, I know you've been busy. We've been trying to set this up for a little over a month, but I really do appreciate you taking the time out and sharing with everybody and what you're doing to get our athletes ready for Rio and the whole deal, man. And just really awesome. I mean, I took 2 pages of notes here, so really appreciate you sharing with everybody.
Well, Ron, thanks again. I mean, like I said, I'm only a product of the people before me, you know, and I just want to continue being a good learner. And I think information that I share, it doesn't work in everybody's area. That's important. So the things we've learned has been successful for us.
Oh, that's great.
So thanks again for your time and thanks for having me on. I appreciate that. Thank you. I'm honored.
That's it for this episode of Iron Game Chalk Talk. Thanks to this week's guest, as well as our sponsors, for bringing this episode to you for free. Make sure to check out ronmckeefery.com, where you can join our mailing list, find the show notes, including all the links and resources mentioned, and information about Coach McKeefery's other products. While you are there, please join Coach McKeefery in the comments section thanking our guest for sharing. If you haven't subscribed to Iron Game Chalk Talk on YouTube or iTunes yet, make sure to do so. Comments, ratings, and reviews are always welcome. Coach McKeefery can be found on Twitter at rmckeefery. On Facebook and YouTube at @ron.mckeefery. That's it for this week. Be sure to check back next week for another great episode of Iron Game Chalk Talk.